Welcome back. In this lesson, we will learn about the convergence of the fission source in Monte Carlo criticality simulations. In the next slides, I'm going to use the so-called fission operator that I'm going to be denoting as H. It's possible to define it mathematically, but I'm not going to do that. I just will define it in the statement, which is written here, that when you apply the fission operator to any fission source that I denote as S, then the operator will return the next generation fission source. I'm going to be denoting the generation index in the brackets in the superscript of the fission source. So when I write S with the superscript n-1, that denotes the fission source in the generation n-1. So when I apply the fission operator on such a source, I will get the next generation fission source, that means the fission source Sn. So let's not forget what the fission source means. It means the distribution of the fission neutrons. So that is a quantity which depends on the position. It depends on the energy, because the fission neutrons have different energy, and then it depends on the direction. So let's take some example. Let's take the example of the slab reactor. So this is my slab containing some fissile material, and I will place it in void. And let's say that it's a supercritical system, and I will introduce fission source there. So this will be the source that I can denote as S0, yeah, the fission source in the generation 0. When I apply the fission operator on this source, the next generation source will look, for instance, like this. So this is the S1. So in case of the Monte Carlo criticality simulations, we call the generation cycles, and we have already learned that we need to keep the population of the neutrons constant over the cycles. And we have learned already that that can be achieved by dividing the fission cross-sections by the multiplication factor. Now this process can be displayed by this formula here. Actually, it's equivalent to dividing the fission operator by the multiplication factor. So we apply the fission operator to the fission source divided by the multiplication factor, and from this distribution we sample the new fission source for the new cycle. So the fission convergence is given by this formula, and the convergence rate is very much dependent on this fission operator. Now we want to run our criticality simulation with a steady state fission source, so that our results are not biased by the incorrect fission source. But we usually don't know the steady state fission source, so we have to start with some fission source which is not steady state. We have to guess the initial fission source as zero. So then as we simulate the cycles, we expect that the fission source will cycle by cycle approach the steady state distribution. So we expect that at some cycle the fission source will become steady state. That means it will stop to change. So what does it mean? When we look at this equation, we see that it means that the fission source on the right hand side as well as the fission source on the left hand side should be the same at the moment when the fission source is converged. Right, so at the moment when the fission sources converge, we can write the equation in this form, where the fission source has the same form on the left hand side as well as on the right hand side of the equation. Now if we move the multiplication factor to the left hand side, and when we look at this equation, you can see that it is in fact the eigenvalue equation, right? We have the eigenvalue here, that's why we call the multiplication factor the k eigenvalue sometimes, and s represents the eigenfunction. So both the eigenvalue and the eigenfunction are given by the properties of the fission operator. Now when you look at this equation, you see that there are two quantities that we want to calculate, the eigenvalue and the eigenfunction, but we only have one equation. So this implies that there are probably more than one solution to this equation. Just one equation, but we have two quantities that we have to calculate. There are in fact infinitely many solutions to this equation, but only one is physical. Now we can index all the possible solutions. So I'm using the index I here to denote different eigenvalues and different eigenfunctions. So for the same I index, we have a eigenvalue and the eigenfunction. So these are relating to each other. We can order all these eigenvalues in such a way that there is one which is the largest and all the other are smaller in the absolute value. So the largest one we can denote by the zero index. So let's denote the largest eigenvalue as k0, the second largest one k1, and the third largest k2, and so on. So we also denote the largest eigenvalue as the fundamental eigenvalue, and the fundamental eigenvalue is associated with the so-called fundamental eigenfunction as 0. Same way as the first higher eigenvalue k1 is associated with the first higher eigenfunction s1. So the k0 and the s0 represent the fundamental mode solution, and we denote all the other solutions as the higher mode solutions. Now when you compare all the possible eigenfunctions, you'll be able to see that only the fundamental eigenfunction is non-negative in the whole system. All the higher solutions are partly positive and partly negative in the system. So those cannot represent the physical solution. So therefore it's only the fundamental mode solution which represents the true physical solution. Let me give you an example. If we take the slab reactor, the fundamental solution is the cosine-like solution, so this is S0. If you look at the first higher mode solution, that would look something like this. So let's say 0 is here. So you see in part of the system, the first higher mode, S1, is negative, right? It's here. Now, if you look at the eigenvalue equation, you can multiply the both sides by -1, and you can see that the same solution will now look like this, right? So this is also the first higher eigenmode. So in fact, you can multiply the eigenfunction by any factor and it will still be the same eigenfunction, right? Because you can always remove the factor from the both sides of the eigenvalue equation. Now the set of the eigenfunctions have specific qualities. For instance, the eigenfunctions are linearly independent to each other. So when you calculate the projection of one eigenfunction onto the other eigenfunction, you will always get zero projection. Now it's also possible to prove that any function in the domain of the operator, the fission operator, can be expressed in terms of the eigenfunctions of the same operator. So any function can be written as a linear combination of the eigenfunctions. So the eigenfunctions are these functions Si, and the linear combination is using these weighting factors gamma. So because any function can be expressed in term of the combination of the eigenfunctions, it's also true for the initial fission source, the S0. So no matter how the initial fission source looks like, we can find the gamma factors such that the combination of different eigenfunctions with these gamma factors will express exactly the initial fission source. Now I'm writing this because it will be very useful on the next slides when we will try to figure out what is the convergence rate. So we are going to substitute this into the eigenvalue equation. So here is our eigenvalue equation. I've made few changes to it. First of all, I am now writing the multiplication factor as the k0, the fundamental mode eigenvalue. And then I'm using the equal sign here. Previously I used the arrow, which denoted the random sampling from the distribution given by the right-hand side. But I have to use the equal sign now because we need to simplify this process. So by using the equal sign, I basically am neglecting the random noise that is introduced into the fission source at every cycle. So at this point I'm neglecting the fact that the random noise is introduced into the fission source at every cycle. So the results that we are going to obtain from these derivations will have this assumption, which is incorrect. However, we have to do it in order to simplify the derivations. Alright, so let's have a look at the eigenvalue equation. Let's write the solution to several cycles. So we start with the fission source S0. So that's our initial fission source. In the next cycle, the fission source S1, according to this equation, is obtained by applying the fission source operator on the fission source S0, and then we divide it by K0. Then the fission source for the next cycle, for the second cycle, S2, will be calculated by applying the fission operator on the S1 source, divided by K0 again. So now if I substitute this result here, I will get the double application of the fission operator on the source S0, S0 divided by K0 squared. Right? So from here you can see that at every cycle we apply the fission operator on the fission source and divide it by the fundamental mode eigenvalue. So we can write the eigenvalue equation also in this form, where we, in the right hand side, we are using the initial fission source, and then we are applying the fission operator n times, and then we have to divide this source by the k0 to the power of nth, right? Now in the previous slide we have learned that the initial fission source as zero can be expressed in terms of the set of the eigenfunctions. So I'm going to substitute that result here. So I remove the S0 and I substitute it by the linear combination of the eigenfunctions. So we have the gamma factors and the different mode eigenfunctions as I here. Now I can move the operator inside the sum, so I can move it here. And when you look at this term, the operator is applied n times on the ith eigenfunction. Now we can express this term using the eigenvalue. Now let me show you why. So we have our eigenvalue equation k times s equals hs, right? And we have many solutions to that, and we have indexed the solutions by the index I. So when you apply the fission operator on the eigenfunction with the I index, it's the same as if you multiply the same eigenfunction by the eigenvalue ki, right? So if you apply the fission operator n times on the si eigenfunction, it's the same as if you multiply the si eigenfunction by the eigenvalue ki n times. So we can do this operation here, just substitute the nth power of the h operator by ki to the power of n. So here is our result. Let's have a look at the terms now. The first term that is denoted by the index I equal to 0, the eigenvalue in the numerator and denominator will cancel out, right? The I is 0 here, so that will cancel out with the eigenvalue in the denominator. So the first term is just the product of gamma 0 and the fundamental mode eigenfunction, S0. However, all the other terms, the higher mode terms, they will have also these additional factors because the eigenvalues will not cancel out, right? The second term, which is denoted by the index 1, will not have the eigenvalues cancelled anymore. There will be k1 in the numerator. So we can write this as k1 divided by k0 to the power of n. Now we have sorted the eigenvalues of different modes in such a way that the k0 is the largest one and the k1 is the second largest one. So that means that we know that this ratio k1 to k0 is smaller than 1, right? It has to be a number which is smaller than 1. So this term is actually decaying in over the cycles. So n is the number of the cycle, Sn is the fission source in cycle n. So you can see that the fission source in our Monte Carlo criticality simulation will converge to the fundamental mode because all the other modes will eventually die out, and that's because ratio of these eigenvalues is always smaller than 1. That's valid for the first higher mode, but also for the second higher mode, because k2 to k0 is also smaller than 1. In fact, we know that k2 is even smaller than k1, so this factor decays even faster over the cycles than this factor. So you can see that the second higher eigenmode will decay faster than the first higher eigenmode, but eventually all these higher modes will die out and the fission source will converge to the fundamental mode. So during the convergence of the fission source, during the inactive cycles, we primarily need to make sure that the first higher eigenmode is not present in the fission source, right? If we know the first higher eigenmode is not in the fission source, then we can say that all the other higher modes are also not present there. Now this can be a problem in case that this ratio k1 to k0 is very close to 1. Now that can happen. You know the k1 is smaller than k0, but the k1 can be very close to k0. So if that happens, then the ratio of k1 to k0 is very close to 1. And if that would be the case, then this term would decay very slowly. So for instance, the ratio k1 to k0 could be 0.999. So in that case, this term would decay very slowly over the cycles. We would need to simulate many inactive cycles to reduce this first higher mode to some negligible amount. So for instance, if we simulated 1000 inactive cycles, we can calculate 0.999 to the power of 1000. That's about 0.37. So you see, this first higher eigenmode would still bias the fission source. It would still introduce quite large error, and the almost 40% of the original error in the fission source would still be present in the fission source even after 1000 of inactive cycles. So this ratio k1 to k0 is called the dominance ratio, because this ratio dominates to the convergence, the fission source. So these are important results to us. So let me just summarize these. The fission source convergence in Monte Carlo criticality calculations is dominated by this ratio k1 to k0. We call it the dominance ratio. And the closer this dominance ratio is to unity, the slower the fission source converges. So if this ratio is very close to unity, we need many inactive cycles in order to decay the errors which are coming from the initial fission source. So do you always need to run many inactive cycles in the systems which have very large dominance ratio? It also depends on the error in the initial fission source. It could happen that you know the steady state from some previous simulation and you can save the fission source and reuse it for the next criticality simulation. So in that case, it would be possible for you to sample the initial fission source without any error or with a very small one. So in that case, of course, you don't have to run any inactive cycles. But again, if you do not know the correct steady state solution, and we usually don't know it, that's why we run the simulation in the first place. So if we sample the initial fission source with some error and we know that the system has a large dependence ratio, close to 1, then we need to simulate a large number of inactive cycles. So what are the systems which have the dominance ratio close to unity? There are two types of systems. The first type represents the large symmetrical systems. So unfortunately for us, these are also large reactors. They are large systems which are symmetrical. They have dominance ratio close to unity. It can be 0.99 something. The other type represents coupled systems. So for instance, when you have two reactive components which look the same, they have the same reactivity, you place them into some distance from each other. These coupled systems, they can have also a very large dominance ratio. And what systems can have a small dominance ratio? Well, typically small systems have a dominance ratio which is small. So for instance, small research reactors, they can have a very small dominance ratio. So the criticality simulation of such a system can converge very quickly. Also, it is possible that a large system could have a small dominance ratio when it's asymmetrical. So for instance, when you introduce the control rods into only one part in the reactor, it becomes asymmetrical and its dominance ratio can drop. So that would improve the source convergence. So because we do not collect any useful information during the inactive cycles, we naturally want to reduce the number of inactive cycles. The only purpose of the inactive cycles is to converge the initial fission source to the steady state. So we want to accelerate the convergence in such a way that we can reduce the number of inactive cycles and to improve the efficiency of the whole simulation. So the question is whether we can improve it in some way. Well, we certainly could if we could decrease the dominance ratio of the system that we model. If we can, then we will improve the convergence rate and the fission source will converge faster from the initial state to the steady state. So is it possible to somehow reduce the dominance ratio of the model? Well, it is. And one way of doing that is by taking advantage of the symmetry of the system. So let's say that we simulate a symmetrical active core. So let's say that we have a cylinder that represents the active core and this is the cross-section of the cylinder. Let's say that the core is symmetrical. So it's filled with the fuel assemblies, but we can, for instance, say that if we model 1/4 of the active core and we find the solution in 1/4, then we can apply the same solution to the rest of the core. Of course, in order to get the correct solution, we need to apply reflective boundary conditions here, right? So now we will simulate the neutron transport in a smaller system where the dominance ratio will be smaller, so the fission source will converge faster within this 1/4 of the system and we can simulate a smaller number of inactive cycles, so we can save some computing cost. And that is all. Have a nice day.